A handful of states and cities are offering incentives in hopes of finding new residents. One of the top destinations, West Virginia. ABC's Kenneth Moten has more.
Tina McPherson is on the cusp of a new adventure and major life change.
Really excited. A little nervous, but really excited.
A fourth-generation Washingtonian, her roots are deep, but she is pulling them up and moving west. West Virginia, that is.
It's just a simpler, slower life, and the cost of living is, like, incredible. Great people, great atmosphere. We're right near the lake.
McPherson is one of nearly 8,000 people who have applied to ascend West Virginia. With the end of the pandemic in sight and the world opening up to remote workers and digital nomads, a handful of states and cities are offering incentives to sweeten the deal in hopes of finding willing city dwellers like McPherson who will pick up and move. A state with exceptional beauty but a shrinking population. Ascend West Virginia hopes to entice telecommuters to have their Zoom calls from Appalachia. The bait, $12,000 along with passes to a variety of outdoor activities for a year. That's $10,000 divided up in monthly payments for the first year and $2,000 at the end of the second, all to indulge in the state's allure.
We have been the frogs that are now really truly proud of their own pond.
The funds for the remote worker program through West Virginia University.
Welcome to wild, wonderful West Virginia.
Donated by Brad Smith, the former CEO of the software company Intuit, and his wife Elise. Smith, a Mountain State native, gifting $25 million. The state has the sixth highest poverty rate in the country at 16%, several points higher than the national average. With nearly 280,000 West Virginians living in the poorest conditions, the goal of Ascend is to dismantle generational poverty by injecting new life and money into the state, focusing on home buying, supporting local businesses, and community engagement.
It's a bold step toward making West Virginia the most attractive state in the nation.
But there are major cons the state is tackling. A dual health crisis unrelated to the COVID-19 pandemic. The state is at the epicenter of the opioid epidemic, and it has the most concerning HIV outbreak in the country, according to the CDC. The Appalachia region runs from northern Mississippi and Alabama all the way up to southern New York.
There are pros and cons of being a small town. I mean, I know everyone here. And I would definitely call that a pro.
But locals call West Virginia the heart of Appalachia.
We come from humble beginnings, and a lot of people are still in those humble beginnings. And it's all about community here, being able to lift each other up.
Community is exactly what's driving people to the Wardensville Garden Market, a social experiment and food-based nonprofit founded by Paul Yandura to elevate this little northeastern corner of the state. The program creates sustainable businesses around town, like a market, a farm, a bakery, and a glass-blowing studio.
Lots of times people feel like we found something here, but it's been here. I mean, the students, the families, the history of the town.
Yandura and his husband Donald moved away from D.C. nearly a decade ago. They were looking for the simple life. They found it, and an opportunity to dust off the sleepy town, population less than 300, and give it new life. One initiative focusing on Wardenville's youth.
We knew that if we had a program that could create opportunities for youth, that we could bring something to the table.
It teaches you responsibility, and you got to get here on time. This is your job. You're supposed to work. And so it's taught me a lot of responsibility, I think. And I've seen that in myself, and it makes me like working here a lot, especially on the farm.
The Wardensville Garden Market is built around the concept that if you give a man a fish, he eats for a day. If you teach him how to fish, he'll eat forever.
Food for me is the best way we can communicate across cultures. No matter who you are, where you come from, food is this catalyst for change and for growth and for understanding.
Down the road, another West Virginian is using food for change, Pupusaria Emerita. With $900 in her pocket, she moved to Moorefield with the dream of opening up a restaurant.
I liked this town. I came to this place through the church, and then I really liked it here.
The naturalized citizen from Honduras is part of a growing Hispanic community. The recent census found West Virginia is just one of four states that suffer suffered a loss in population, but an increase in the Latino population.
And what makes me most glad is that people are humble. People are humble because it doesn't matter how they eat. If it's packed here, they'll just set up outside and then eat there because they really like pupusas.
Emerita bringing her recipes and her culture to these hills.
West Virginia.
As for the newest West Virginian to embark on the many twists and turns on those country roads, McPherson is excited for her new adventure.
I just think really it's the people that are drawing me to West Virginia, not just the beauty of the state, which is absolutely stunningly beautiful.
Both wild and wonderful, today's West Virginia hopes to be an incentive for those who are seeking a change of scenery. Kenneth Moten, ABC News, Washington.
Kenneth, thank you. Now, there are still plenty of questions about this program. One state delegate, Danielle Walker, tells ABC News that Ascend West Virginia should start with West Virginia. She says more needs to be done to keep people in the state and take care of them when they're there. So let's dig in a little deeper here. It still remains to be seen whether West Virginia's bet pays off, but what do we already know about people have changed where they lived? Jed Coco, chief economist of Indeed and co-author of the New York Times article, How the Pandemic Did and Didn't Change Where Americans Move, is here with more on this. Jed, thanks so much for being here. I'd like to get your reaction first to Kenneth's piece. Do you think there's an opportunity here for places like West Virginia to get a population boost from telework?
I think that the pandemic and the increase in remote work has the opportunity to widen chances for lots of people in lots of places. One of the advantages of remote work is that it brings people who can't move to jobs that are elsewhere, and also lets employers who may be located away from where a labor force is to hire remotely as well. So I think there are some people in places who will see expanded opportunities because of remote work. But overall, what we saw in the pandemic is that migration patterns largely followed the patterns that we saw before the pandemic. Places that grew continued to grow more or not shrink as much. Places that suffered prior to the pandemic continued to lose more people than others. So it was mostly a continuation of existing patterns.
So the underlying forces, as you're saying, that were there before the pandemic didn't cure them. This article in the New York Times, so interesting. You know, the data that you looked at, the change of address requests out of the post office to see how people moved, among other things. The top 10 list of where people migrated to, and we're looking at it, Hudson, New York, Kingston, New York, Torrington, Connecticut, Barnstable Town, Mass. There's some from Heber, Utah, Pittsfield, Mass. It's the Northeast, so... You know, what is it? Panama City, Florida is in there, Aberdeen, Washington. So you draw some conclusions from that. It's not like people moved to Streeter, Illinois, where my brother lives, or to West Virginia. They moved kind of near the major population centers. What's happening?
The biggest trends that we saw during the pandemic were some moves out of New York and the San Francisco Bay Area, especially by people who were living in more expensive neighborhoods. And some of the places they moved to included vacation towns, places where there are a lot of second homes. But for the most part, these were shorter distance moves. People who were moving to where they had a second home or a nearby vacation town, or maybe just to a suburb a little farther out where they could get more space inside and outside, room to work more comfortably from home, that's more affordable. And if people are working from home, they might not need to make that commute every day or even three times a week. They can live 2 hours from their job if they're only going in once a week, even though they would not want to do that commute every day.
Yeah, but when you look at the cities where people left in big numbers, we did see the big ones like San Francisco, New York, Seattle, Boston. But we're also seeing some small towns like Lake Charles, Louisiana, Odessa, Texas. What do you take away from this list?
Well, those small towns are a reminder that other things happened during the pandemic besides the pandemic. There was also a downturn in the energy industry, and that hurt some oil-dependent towns. And there were natural disasters. Lake Charles, Louisiana, suffered hurricanes. Parts of Northern California suffered wildfires. And we saw big out-migrations from those places as well during the pandemic, on top of all the challenges that the pandemic created.
So, Jed, as more people get vaccinated and more of us have to go back to the office, are people returning to these major cities? Do you think this was a temporary exodus?
I think some of the permanent moves are going to be within the same labor market, within the same broad area, but maybe a little farther out. People who might have been working at home all the time during the pandemic, and they're going to switch to a hybrid schedule, maybe going in 2 days a week. They can live a little farther from the office, get a bit more space, and stay a little farther from downtown. But for the most part, the pandemic does not mean people moving from the city or suburb they were in to the mountaintop or the beach or that other idyllic fantasy vacation spot. And for the most part, even people who are working remotely part of the time still need to be within a long commuting distance of their office. And even if people can work remotely now, they might want to be near a big job market the next time they want to search for a job. So those are all reasons why we aren't likely to see people abandoning cities and a huge increase in migration.
Well, my Facebook Moms group indicates a lot of families are coming back to New York City, Jed. So the Facebook Moms group, that's the data you're up against.
There you go. And it's great to see the places that suffered now coming back.
It sure is. Jed Coco, we so appreciate your time today. Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.